One of the biggest advantages of modern EFI systems is their ability to monitor atmospheric conditions and make changes to both fuel and ignition timing to cope with those changes. Now, this is obviously really important when we're at an event like Pikes Peak International Hill Climb, where we're climbing up a hill that peaks at over 14,000 feet. The atmospheric pressure at the summit of Pikes Peak is incredibly low. This means there's less oxygen available in the air, and this affects the way the engine performs. So we took the opportunity to grab Adam from Smart EFI aside. He's the tuner for the Enviate Hypercar, and I wanted to take the opportunity to just discuss with Adam what tuning changes he's making based on that high altitude at Pikes Peak. So first of all, Adam, can we just go over what the hardware for the EFI system in this car is so we know what we're dealing with?
Yeah, we're actually doing something really basic. So we started with a Haltech Elite 2500 ECU, and we actually ended up using the Haltech LS engine harness that they manufacture that basically just lay on the motor. And then we added to that to add all additional sensors. The car is set up so that we can monitor shock travel, shock velocity, wheel speed, steering angle, clutch pressure, brake pressure, you name it. We pretty much wired it so that it can be there. At this point in time, we're actually monitoring very little of that. We're doing basic engine changes. So we've got obviously manifold pressure, exhaust back pressure, turbine speed, and
that's lambda as well.
Lambda, of course. Yeah, sorry. And we have a Haltech dual channel wideband on it, so we're utilizing that, and it's working extremely well, giving us really accurate measurements. So that's been really, really great to work with. Obviously, using components that are all manufactured by the same company generally makes it much easier for the whole system to work together, and you fight that a lot less.
Now, what are the challenges you face when you perhaps tune a car like this at low altitude? I mean, we're here in Colorado Springs, where we're still at about 2,000 meters in altitude. But what challenges do you face when you're tuning a car at relatively low altitude, and then it's going to compete at much higher altitude at Pikes Peak?
So when you're tuning at altitude versus at sea level, a lot of people think that fueling is the big difference. What we've learned is that actually isn't the truth. When you have a proper VE model and it's modeled correctly with accurate data so that the math is actually correct, then when you actually go to altitude, yeah, there is a fueling change because the air density changes, but it's not as significant as people think. We're actually only seeing a 7% increase in fueling at the peak versus at the base, the summit, the starting line for this race.
So just to go back on that, so you're actually increasing the fueling by 7% from where you start at the base of the hill climb to the summit?
Correct, yeah, which is counterintuitive. You would think that you would need to decrease the fuel, but and in theory you would, but in reality what we found is that that's not the case. It actually requires more fuel. So we added 7% at the peak versus what we were at the base. And what we also found was at the base, the percentage difference from sea level was only about 3 to 4%. So it really surprised me. This is my first time up here on the mountain, and I obviously came into it with an expectation, and the mountain has taught me a lot. So excited to be learning that.
So it's interesting because, as you say, that's definitely counterintuitive. Obviously, as you go up in altitude, the air density decreases, so you would assume or think that less fuel would be required. I'm just interested to delve into how you're applying that correction to the VE or the fuel map, how you're applying that correction as the car goes up the towards the summit.
Yeah, so right now we use an external sensor on the engine for manifold pressure, and we're using actually the onboard Haltech sensor for the ECU to measure barometric pressure as we go up the mountain. What we've found is basically I just have a percentage change on barometric pressure for the VE curve, and it's been really accurate. So what we did was, you know, up at the top of the mountain, I just made a baro change and linearized down to where we were at the base. And I'm just checking it, you know, every day to make sure it's where I think it should be. And it is a fairly linear change, which is what I expected for pressure changes. But I think my belief is that the air temperature change from coming out of the turbos, because they're working so much harder at altitude to make the same boost pressure, is why we have to add fuel. So I believe what the issue is that's making me add this change is that the air temp correction is not quite where I wanted it to be. But that's something you really can't discover at sea level unless you put the car into those situations.
I think that's one of the things that a lot of people overlook with these modern ECUs. Even though we've got very advanced fuel models on the likes of the Haltech Elite ECU, we are still talking about an ECU that is applying a generic fuel model that's supposed to be accurate enough to work on thousands of engines. So it is likely that there will be potentially some discrepancy creep in, and the fuel model may not be 100% accurate across the board. Would that be a reasonable thing to say?
Yeah, for sure. And a lot of it is also that, you know, if you look at an OEM calibration, they test those calibrations in so many different environments. We're so limited on what we can do because of the time constraint. They spend thousands of hours calibrating an engine. We're spending a few, you know, at best, and sometimes 10, 20. You know, we have obviously a lot of work into this calibration up here, but it's little bits in comparison to what an OEM ECU is capable of doing. It's not that it's not capable to do it. It's the amount of time that it takes to build that model from nothing. You know, standalones, they don't have the stock map that out of a car. You start from nothing and you have to build your maps from scratch. So we skip steps, really. I mean, to put it bluntly, we skip steps to save time and to meet the needs that we're, you know, facing, because we don't always tune cars that go all over the planet. We generally tune for one environment.
Now, just with those discrepancies in the fueling that you're talking about, and I mean, even if we're competing at a fixed altitude, maybe at a racetrack, it is typical to see small discrepancies in the air fuel ratio from one lap to another, as some of the operating conditions vary outside of the conditions we saw when we tuned it. And a common technique to combat that, those small variations that we're seeing, would be to use closed loop air fuel ratio or lambda control. Is that something you're using on the Enviate Hypercar?
Yeah, definitely. A lot of people are scared of closed-loop O2 control. They're worried that, you know, it'll overshoot or undershoot and put you in conditions that you wouldn't foresee. We log the change that the controller is making, and then I make my adjustments to the map based on that, and then watch the trims change lap to lap. So, you know, like I said, first day when we got up to the top of the mountain, it was adding 8%, so I put 7% fuel in the map. And bam, my trims were at 1%. So that's how I knew what to do. The ECU does all the work for you, and you just read the data out and say, okay, great, here's the change. And you have to figure out where the most effective place to make that change was. I knew the VE map was correct at sea level. So obviously changing the VE map isn't the answer. You have to change a correction. So barometric pressure made the most sense at the time. You know, now that we're running at the base of the mountain, and seeing more conditions and seeing how the car develops, in hindsight, maybe barometric pressure isn't perfect, but it definitely has a lot to do with it. So there are definitely different varying factors that you have to consider, and you just decide what's the best change for your application at the time.
Now, when it comes to a turbocharged car, running at higher altitude, and there is the argument that in terms of the fuel requirements, manifold pressure is manifold pressure, and the absolute manifold pressure is really the key element that the ECU needs to know. But another side effect that is probably often overlooked is, as we go up in altitude, the barometric pressure drops. If we want to maintain a fixed manifold absolute pressure, what this means is we actually have to drive the turbochargers harder. They're working at a higher pressure ratio, and in turn this increases the exhaust manifold back pressure. So how do you see the exhaust manifold back pressure playing into your tuning?
It's actually a big effect. What we found is we needed more power on the mountain than what we needed at sea level. The car wants more. As we get the chassis dialed in, the driver wants more. So we keep putting more boost into the engine, and obviously as we do that, as we command more boost duty, the back pressure increases. So you're fighting that balance. You know, as boost pressure goes up, back pressure goes up. What we've actually found is that our turbine housings are too small up here. So when we went to make 20 pounds of boost on this engine, we couldn't. You could put 100% boost duty in there, and all you see is the drive pressure just skyrocket. You don't actually get any more boost pressure. You just get tons of back pressure because the wastegate won't let any of the pressure out of the exhaust. And it actually ends up hurting power. A lot of people don't realize that when you run out of efficiency, if you just keep asking for more, you're just going to hurt, you know, your goal. So what we've decided is we're going to try and get some new back housings on it to be able to be more efficient and allow us that headroom so we can make more power up top.
Just while we're talking about the turbochargers, you've also got turbo speed as an input. So what relevance is that to you when you're looking at the data? How are you using that to help you modify the tune?
Yeah, so obviously as we increase wastegate duty, that increases drive pressure, which increases drive speed. So especially at altitude where the air is less dense, the turbocharger has to speed up to make the same amount of pressure that we're commanding. So we're obviously commanding more duty, which is more drive pressure, which is more speed. Unfortunately, there's a really fine line and a balance there. But what a lot of people don't realize is you can really push the turbochargers harder than you'd expect. They're really robust, especially the newer units. They're in really good shape. We have Garrett Gen 2s on the car right now, and they're really, really stout. So to me, turbine speed isn't a huge concern as long as we're not fighting back pressure. So, you know, you have to be smart about what you're doing, but overall, the turbine speed is just kind of what it is, and we're just monitoring to make sure we're not working the turbochargers too hard. They're pretty happy right now at about 16 pounds of boost. We can squeeze 18 or so out of it. But again, you know, your drive pressure goes up, your turbine speed goes up a ton to make that extra 2 pounds of boost. But in this car, 2 pounds of boost is 150 horsepower. So it's a big change.
All right, let's just talk a little bit about the data that you're looking at when the car's running on the mountain, and particularly in practice, we're very limited on the time frame. So can you talk me through the process that you go through when the car comes back from a run?
Yeah, so obviously you've been on the mountain. It's really stringent as far as timeline goes. We get on the mountain at about 3:30 in the morning, and we have to be off by 9:30 in the morning, like not just packed up, but off the mountain by 9:30. So that really gives us a 6-hour window to not only unload the car, prep the car, race the car, and get the car back in the trailer. So between runs, when we bring the car back, the first thing I do is straight on the laptop, connect to the ECU, pull the data out, and view the data. For me, with the stringent timelines, because I know that the engine is healthy, and I know basically where we're at as far as the tune goes, I'm really quick with it. I look at oil pressure, oil temperature, and coolant temperature were my biggest priorities. A lot of people don't know about the mountain's strenuous activity on your cooling system. It is the biggest, hardest item for people to tackle up here. The air is really thin. It's hard to get enough airflow across your radiator. We actually have 2 on the car and about 3.5 gallons worth of fluid. So a really, really high capacity system that still fights cooling issues.
I'll just go into that a little bit deeper and just sort of for those of our listeners who don't really understand what that means. So while the lower air density means the engine is struggling to make power, that lower air density also affects the ability for us to dissipate heat out of the radiators, out of the oil coolers. So that coupled with the fact that for a lot of the course, Pikes Peak's actually relatively low speed. So you've got the engine working incredibly hard, high RPM, sustained high RPM, but relatively low vehicle speed. So you're not getting that airflow across the radiators. So it's sort of a perfect storm of a situation that really adds up to make a cooling system that works perfectly at sea level really, really struggle. That's what you're finding?
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of the teams struggle with it. But we were really fortunate to overcome our cooling issues on day one. So we went up on the mountain, we found some issues with our cooling system, we came back and addressed them. But that's always the one thing that you're looking for, because oil pressure, oil temperature, and coolant temperature are the 3 things that will really ruin your day. You know, if you have a boost leak, you can go back and fix it. If you have a cylinder down, you can go back and fix it. But if your, you know, oil temperature goes to 350 degrees, that's gonna ruin your day. You know, same thing with oil pressure falling off or coolant temp going crazy. So that's the thing that we're most cognizant about, is make sure that the car is healthy enough to go back out for another run. And then everything else is secondary. So after I get through those three pieces of data and make sure that we didn't go over our limits and our targeted areas of where we wanted to be in the tune, we look at obviously engine RPM, where was the driver at as far as, you know, in the power band for most of the run, what was the average engine RPM. We look at manifold pressure, how much did it make? Did we make more boost than we wanted, less boost than we wanted, right exactly where we wanted? What was boost duty cycle doing to achieve those numbers? And then obviously check the wide bands and the knock control. So it seems like a lot, but I go through it really quickly. Obviously with knock data, it's usually really apparent if you have a knock event. So you can look at that really briefly. And if you don't see a knock event, move it out of the way and move on to the next thing.
And just talking about that, so you're running on Sunoco 118 octane, which is a petroleum-based fuel. It's not an alcohol-based fuel. So this engine on that fuel is still knock limited at 9:1 compression?
It's not. Not that we've found. So we run it really conservatively. I know that there is a knock limit. We haven't been there. We look at the plugs fairly frequently to make sure that we're where we want to be on the tune-up. We're probably 3 or 4 degrees down from the peak timing value that we could put in the engine, but obviously longevity is priority number one at this race. We can make all the power in the world by just throwing boost at the engine. So conservative timing keeps it alive. And we run with that theory that be conservative, be easy on it, and it will last all the way up the mountain.
Just one last thing that I wanted to touch on as well is you've obviously got a lot of ways with this particular car, given the adjustability and the suspension and also the aero package. You've got a lot of ways of improving its performance. You can make adjustments to suspension, you can make adjustments to downforce, or you can also make adjustments to the power the engine's producing. Do you find that there is one specific area that's really the key? Is it engine performance or is it chassis performance when it comes to getting those improvements, or do they all have to really go hand in hand?
They really go hand in hand. Obviously, without the chassis set up properly, you can make all the power in the world and not put it down, and it does you no good. But with all the chassis in the world, if you don't have any power, you can't get up the mountain. It's not a downhill race. It's an uphill race. So you need power and torque to do that. So it's a fine balance. We work on all of it at the same time. It's really a mad scramble with very little sleep. This mountain definitely tests not only the car, but the team. You know, do you have the metal to see it from day one to day 10? You know, it's a really long week, really testing the car, putting it through its paces. But you know, you have to balance, you have to talk to the driver and see what the driver wants. And you have to talk to the chassis people and see, you know, is it pushing? Do I need more power here? You know, we've done a lot of adjusting actually in the low RPM ranges. What we found was going into the turns and coming out of the turns, we were slowing down so much that the engine was dropping out of power and just didn't have enough torque to accelerate out of the turn the way we wanted to. So we basically went into that low load area where we're not making really much boost and really low RPM and just threw a ton of timing at it. To wake the car up there, and the driver's really happy with that. So, you know, it's an orchestra. You gotta, you know, get everybody to play together, and everybody's playing the same tune, and you get a successful project. And so far, we've been really successful, and we're really happy with where we're at.
I think that is an area that is often overlooked, and people tend to think they can focus on just one aspect, be it engine performance or the chassis. So as you say, you really need everything working in harmony to get the best possible results. Well, look, it's Thursday here and you've completed the second day of practice on the middle section of the mountain, and despite a severe ignition misfire, which had the engine I think running on five cylinders. You still put in second fastest in the unlimited class. So it's a pretty impressive place to be on Thursday. Thanks for the chat, Adam, and we really look forward to seeing how the car progresses and what it can do on Sunday.
Really appreciate it, and really glad to talk to you guys about it.
Thanks.